Hello students, good morning. So we are going to start with our daily current affairs. So today you will have 25th to 25th of December, and Merry Christmas also from the Future IAS Academy. All right, and myself Pushpendra Singh, and we are going to cover today's current affairs from the Hindu newspaper. Okay, so I have already given you the newspaper. So that newspaper is basically the Hindu. So you should read the Hindu newspaper. That is your daily current, for your daily current affairs. You can also refer Indian Express also. Okay, so any of these newspaper would suffice for the daily current affairs. You can read both also, right? Or either of these newspaper also will be suffice. Okay, so all right. So let's begin with the current affairs, daily current affairs for 25th of December 2020. All right. So the first news which is coming here is Tasokar wetland complex. All right. So first let us understand what is wetland. Then we'll start with the wetland complex. Okay. So what is the wetland first of all? So wetland is basically, you can say that it is that land where the water level is very near to the surface. All right. So wetland is the place where the water level is very, very near to the earth surface. All right. So here you will have the different type of vegetation, different type of flora, different type of fauna, which are also called the wetland flora and the faunas, right? So such type of wetlands are of different type. For example, the marshlands, you have lot of, you know, the places where the water is basically some sort of, you know, there you will have some sort of anaerobic, you know, type of climate where you know, the aerobic bacteria and virus will not be available. So you will have the paucity of the oxygen in such type of wetlands. But such wetlands are very luxurious and they are also very productive also. So you will have the different type of species, both floral and faunal species will be found over there. And such wetlands are considered very rich, right, in terms of such composition. And they are generally the site of the scenic beauty. And they are also considered the site of the tourist purposes also because of their rich faunal and floral composition. All right. So these are the wetlands. Now let's begin with the news that is called Tasokar wetland complex. So first of all, the news which is flashing is that India has added the Tasokar wetland complex, which is basically located in the Ladakh, as a 42nd Ramsar site, right? Which is the second one from the Union Territory of Ladakh. So two things you must understand here, right? Through the Jammu and Kashmir Reorganization Act, we have made the Ladakh as a Union Territory, all right? And the second thing is that there is a Ramsar sites which are the only sites where the wetlands are located, right? So they are also called the wetlands which are in the need of conservation, So Ramsar is basically a place where the Ramsar Convention was held in 1970s. All right. So through this Ramsar Conventions, the wetlands were started protecting under the Ramsar sites. All right. So throughout the world, such Ramsar sites have been incorporated under Ramsar Conventions in the list of Ramsar sites. Now, from India, it is a 42nd Ramsar site which has to be protected and which is located in the Ladakh Union Territory of India. All right. And it is the second site when you compare with when you say the Ladakh, from the Ladakh, it is the second site. Now, let's understand what is the meaning of Tasokar means. Tasokar means white lake. Okay. Why it is called white lake? Because you must understand the Ladakh region is basically an arid place. Okay. It is basically a cold arid place. So there you have basically some sort of a white efflorescence, right? This white efflorescence is because of the salt. The salt which is found on the margins of the lake, right? Where you will have, because of the evaporation of the water, what is left out is ultimately is the salt. And this salt is basically gave you the white appearance or the white efflorescence. And that is the reason the Tasokar, the wetland, is also considered as the white lake because of this efflorescence, which is causing because of the salt deposition at their margins. Now, the news which is coming around, which is coming for the Tasokar wetland complex. Now you must understand, when you say the complex means it also involves certain other bodies also. Okay, so these complex, for example, the Tasokar Basin, basically, first of all, is a high altitude complex. Why we call the high altitude? Because Ladakh itself is located on the high altitude region. All right, altitude means at the from the mean sea level, the level of the location of the site would be at higher level, right? So that is why it is called high altitude wetland complex. Now, the complex itself signifies that it has multiple bodies. So that is why it has two principal water bodies with it, right? These are the two principal water bodies. For example, the one water body is called Start Sapuk Taso, right? This Start Sapuk Taso is basically a freshwater lake, right? Which is around 438 hectares to the south of this basin, right? So you must understand, this is a freshwater lake which is lying to the south of the Tasokar Basin. And there is itself a hypersaline lake, which is named as Tasokar Lake, okay? Which is of 1800 hectares of the area, and this is located to the north of the Tasokar Basin. So you must understand, the Tasokar wetland complex consisting of the two principal water bodies. The first is called the Start Sapuk Taso, which is a freshwater lake which is located to the south of the complex, and the second is Tasokar, the lake itself, which is a hypersaline lake, which is not a freshwater lake. You must understand, it is located to the north of the wetland complex. And all these, you know, Tasokar wetland complex is located in the Ladakh region, right? In the Ladakh, the precisely, if you want to say that, Changthang region of the Ladakh. And Ladakh has recently made a union territory of Delhi, the union territory of India. All right. So which is also made through the Jammu and Kashmir Reorganization Act. So all right, this is the news which is coming out. So why we call it a white lake? Tasokar means it is a white lake because of the salt effervescence which is deposited on the margins of this wetland. Okay, now the Tasokar basin, now you have just studied the Tasokar basin consisting of the two water bodies. One is at the freshwater, second is at hypersaline water body. Now this basin is also in the A1 category of important bird area. Okay, so it has been classified as an important bird area, right? This important bird area have been classified or have been given the concept by the Wildlife International, and it is a key site, right, in the Central Asian Flyway. Central Asian Flyway means there are certain birds which are called migratory birds. These birds used to migrate from Siberia or the Central Asian countries. These birds used to fly thousands of the kilometers from the Siberia or from the deeper portion of Central Asia, right? You must understand, during the winter season, there is a chilling cold. The temperature reaches to minus 40, minus 50 degrees Celsius. And in such, you know, cold situations, these birds, which are also having their breeding season during the winter, they may not survive, right? Even the birds may survive, but their small, small babies may not survive during this Chilean cold. So because of that, to safeguard, they basically migrate from the Central Asia, from the Siberian region to Indian, you know, some Indian spots, right? So you must understand, it is a site in the Central Asian Flyway, and few of these birds also reaches up to the Rajasthan. Okay, you might have heard about the bird sanctuary which is located at Bharatpur in the Rajasthan region. So this bird sanctuary, which is located in the Bharatpur region in the Rajasthan itself, is a bird sanctuary. Its name itself, Kevladev Bird Sanctuary, where you will find lot of Central Asian birds like Siberian cranes and lot of other cranes also you will be finding, like black-necked crane. Such birds used to migrate thousands of the kilometers reaching up to the Rajasthan. All right. This site, which is also one of the most important breeding areas of black-necked crane, right, in India. So the black-necked crane, which basically migrated from the Central Asia, right, or from, you know, some of the Siberian region also, is also a site of the breeding site. The important bird area is also a major breeding area for great crested grave, bar-headed geese, right? These are all different birds. The ruddy suldock, okay, the brown headed gull and the lesser sand plover and many other species. So these are the main species where the breeding site is located at the Tasokar Basin. All right, so I hope it is clear. The Tasokar Basin is also an important wildlife, the bird area, because it is lying in the Central Asian Flyway, and it is also the most important breeding areas of the different type of bird species. All right, and it is also incorporated in the Ramsar site. So this Tasokar wetland complex incorporated in the Ramsar site, which is a 42nd Ramsar site from the India, and it is a second site right from the Union Territory of Ladakh. All right, so this is the news which is flashing in the Hindu newspaper. All right, so this is the lake. So this is Tasokar Lake. All right, and you can see how the beautiful and fascinating is the lake is. So there is no such vegetation because, as I told you, it is located at the high altitudes, and it is also the arid region. It is also in the cold and arid region also. All right, let's move to the second news, which is FASTag, which is a FASTag. All right, everyone understand FASTag. There is no need to explain this one. Okay, even some of you might be using this FASTag on your windshield of your car. All right, so what is the news in the today's newspaper is the Union Minister of Road Transport and the Highways announced the FASTag is being made mandatory for all vehicles in the country from the new year. All right, so from the new year, that means from 1st January 2021, the FASTag have become mandatory for all vehicles. That means including the older vehicles also. That means you have no option but to stick the FASTag on your vehicles from the 1st of January 2021, right? Now, let's have the brief understanding about the FASTag. Okay, so let's have the brief understanding about the FASTag. So FASTags were basically launched in the year of 2016. Okay, the main reason behind the launching of this FASTag is basically to make the plazas, or basically the different type of plazas which are there, the cash free, right? So that there is a seamless movement of the vehicles, right, when they pass through different type of toll plazas. So as you move in the highways, along the highways, you will have the different type of toll plazas, isn't it? These toll plazas are there so that they can collect the money, right, from the moving vehicles, and such money would be used for the maintenance, for the construction of the stretch of the road on which you are moving, isn't it? So the whole purpose of the collecting of the money is to maintenance and the construction of the roads under which such the toll plazas have been located. All right, now through the notification, now this FASTags have become mandatory from the 1st January 2021. Even in the old vehicles, which are also sold before 1st December 2017, right? So you must understand, because all the vehicles which are sold since 1st December 2017, the FASTags have been made mandatory for all registration of new four-wheeled vehicles. But those vehicles which were sold before 1st December 2017 also, according to notification, as per the Central Motor Vehicle Rules 1989, the FASTag would be mandatory. The FASTag would be mandatory even for those vehicles which were sold before 1st December 2017. All right. So this is the news which is flashing. Now, when you say why this mandatory, the thing have been made by Union Minister for the Road Transport and the Highways, because you must understand, there is a lot of man hours which is wasted at the toll plazas, right? You might have seen the long queues, which is basically there for the trucks, the commercial trucks, commercial vehicles. If they stand on, say, for 25% of their time or 25% of their transit time along the toll plazas, how much is the time they are wasting? They are wasting 25% of their time, and which is the huge man hours, and which is also unnecessary wastage of the fuel, isn't it? So a lot of other issues are involved. Even such things are related to the economies of the scale. So in order to make the seamless movement of the vehicles all along the plazas, and there is a one more point also here to be noted, that lot of toll plazas have become the home of corruption also, because these toll plazas people are basically, you know, have colluded with the corrupt people, and they may allow some of the corrupt politicians and corrupt local, you know, leaders to pass through even without collecting the tax or without collecting this toll. So again, in order to ensure that 100% toll collections taken place in India through this toll plaza, you must understand that this FASTag is very, very important, should be stick on the windshield of the car or windshield of your moving vehicle. So, right. So this would be basically, a great step in that direction. And now most important point is that, because every vehicle required, you know, certain set of the fitness certificate. Okay. That fitness certificate through this, you know, notification also, it has been mandated that the fitness certificate for a vehicle will be only obtained only after the fitment of the FASTag for the transport vehicle. That means without fitment of the FASTag for the transport vehicle, you cannot achieve your renewal of the fitness certificate for the vehicle. So this is also a good step in this direction, All right, the next is, for national permit vehicles, the fitment of the FASTag was mandated since 1st October 2019. All right. So all such things have been taken place in order to ensure that there is a seamless movement of traffic along, in the basically toll plazas. Now even through the notification, it had been mandated that if anyone want, right, a new third party insurance, right, you have to take it from the amendment in the form of Form 51, right? And such third party insurance will be given only when it is obtained the details of the FASTag ID. So that means the details of the FASTag ID will be needed for the obtaining of third party insurance for your vehicle. And that will be effective, right, from 1st of April 2021. All right. And as I told you, this would be a major step for ensuring the payment of the fee would be 100% at the toll plazas, right? Because as I told you, a lot of peoples which are moving through their vehicles, they don't pay, right? If you put them automatic deduction of, you know, the fee through these vehicles, you can ensure that 100% of the payment will be deposited. 100% payment will be deposited through electronic means. And that will also have, you know, the added advantage of the seamless movement of, you know, the fee-free plazas, right? There is no need to collect the fee, right? And there would be no waiting time also, because a lot of waiting time will be there at the plazas, and a lot of fuel also will be saved through this process. All right. So everything is interlinked, and if you make the FASTag compulsory for all the vehicles, it will be good for the national economy also. All right. So this is the FASTag. You might have seen this picture, right? So this is the vehicles which are moving. So this line is basically cashless. Cashless means they are basically, you know, incorporated or attached with the FASTag. So only the FASTag vehicles can pass through these lanes, right? So these vehicles are basically, you know, no need to wait for these, you know, for the collection of the fee. They can automatically, you know, put a FASTag on the windshield, and this, you know, the money will be deducted automatically at the approach the toll plazas, and these vehicles will let allow to move through the toll plazas also. All right. So this is what is something which is the government of India is planning to do. All right. So let's move to the third news of the today. Okay. So third news is basically Swachhata Abhiyan. So what is this Swachhata Abhiyan? So you must understand, the Swachhata Abhiyan was already launched by the government of India. Now the news which is flashing is the Union Minister for Social Justice and Empowerment, okay, has launched a mobile application. So it is a mobile application which is known as Swachhata Abhiyan. Okay. Why this mobile application is launched? It is basically launched to identify and to geotag the insanitary latrines and manual scavengers. Insanitary latrines are those latrines which are open pit and which are not connected to any sort of a sewer network, right? And such type of latrines where the manual scavengers are needed to to make them clean, right? So such toilets or such latrines would be identified, and such latrines would be geotagged, and such manual scavengers also would be geotagged through this Swachhta Abhiyan, which is a mobile application app, right? So this is basically an innovative step where you can basically geotagging them, you are identifying them so that they can be eliminated, right? So through this app, the citizens means we the people of country can download this app. Okay, when we download this app, it will be available on your app section, so you can just type it out, Swachhta Abhiyan. Okay, so you will get an app, mobile application, and through that the concern, if you see anyone, right, anyone which is doing a manual scavenging work, or anyone, or you just look somewhere any sort of a insanitary latrines, okay, so you can just ensure that, or you can just send a notice to the concerned authority, and they can basically alert by this notice. Okay, so why this thing, you will basically help in the rehabilitation of manual scavengers. Okay, because such manual scavengers are still there in our country, and many manual scavengers are also getting killed during this this operation, and it is very dirty and filthy also, right? And through this move, the insanitary latrines would be replaced by a sanitary ones. Okay, so this is how this Swachhta app or Swachhta Abhiyan app will be ultimately helping to eradicate the manual scavenging work, and also it will also help in the eradication of the insanitary latrines from the India. Okay, so ultimately through this app, the authorities will get the details of any sort of insanitary latrines or manual scavenger if they notice. All right, so they notice means if the citizens they notice. All right, so they will provide the concerned authority some sort of a details about them, and they can get alerted because of that. Okay, you might have seen this pit where this person is basically a manual scavenger who is basically entering into this pit for cleaning this area. Okay, now this is also death dive because nobody knows what will happen, and there is lot of toxic gases also, like ammonia, right, methane, lot of toxic gases also generated, right, at that level. Now if the people entered without some sort of a protective gear, the people generally die because of the suffocation or because of such poisonous gases. All right, so you can see here from 1993 to 2019, okay, almost 814 deaths occur during such cleaning, during such insanitary toilet cleaning by manual scavengers. So such things are basically ongoing even after making the stringent laws and stringent some sort of a penal provisions, but still this such type of practices are still going on, and sanitary workers are continuing to lose their life from suffocation, right, because of such poisonous gases, methane, ammonia and such other poisonous gases which are basically found at the deeper level. Okay, you can see here the Tamil Nadu, which is the topmost, which basically where the 206 people lost their life, followed by the Gujarat where 156 people lost their life, and followed by Uttar Pradesh where 78 people lost their life, followed by Karnataka where 73 people lost their life. So cumulatively, if you see from 1993 to 2019, right, according to the data which is compiled from the National Commission for the Safai Karmacharis, 814 people lost their life in the sewers which are related to the insanitary latrines, and such manual scavengers are still continue to lose their life during this operation. All right, so the government of India is very sincere about eradicating this meanness from the society which is related to such type of conditions. All right, so let's move to the new news. All right, so new news is basically Zoomy. What is this Zoomy? So first of all, you must understand Zoomy is an ethnic group. There's a different type of, first of all, you must understand a ethnic group which is basically having different type of ethnicity. Okay, such Zumi ethnic group are found in the Manipur. Manipur is basically a state in the northeastern region of India, in the northeastern state. So it's basically a northeastern state where the Zumi ethnic group is basically living. All right. All right. So let's understand who is Zumi. So Zumi is basically an ethnic group which is basically staying in the Manipur state of northeastern states of the India. Now, these Zumis, which already under, you know, this Zumi is basically demanding for a creation of Zuland Territorial Council. Zuland's Territorial Council. Now, this Zuland Territorial Council should be established under 6th schedule of the constitution. It will be a self-administered zone on the lines of the Bodoland Territorial Council, which is located in the Assam. Okay, so just like a Bodo's people, just like a Bodo's people, the government of India has set up the Bodoland Territorial Council for basically which are staying in the Assam, is the Assam state of India. Now, these are basically the territorial councils are basically self-administered council where certain type of administrative power, certain type of, you know, judicial power, certain type of financial power have been devolved to this territorial councils, and these territorial councils are basically having responsibility of administering a certain areas, and such areas would be called territory or for which is basically habitated by the Bodo's people. So just like on the lines of Bodoland Territorial Council, which is located in the Assam, right, a Zuland Territorial Council should be set up, and it is demanded by the Manipur's Zumi ethnic group, right, which is still demanding that the Zumi Territorial Council should be set up on the lines of the Bodo Territorial Councils under 6th schedule of the constitution. Now, this Zau people, which are also called Zumi people, first of all, you must understand they are the indigenous community. They are the indigenous community and which are living along the frontiers of India and the Burma. Okay, frontiers of India and Burma, that means they are staying basically at the border of India and the Burma. Burma means Myanmar. So they are basically subgroups of Zo people. Zo people means it is the Mizo and the Koki and the Sim. These three people are considered as a Zo people. So they are basically subgroup. Otherwise, they are considered as a separate ethnic group, which is also called the Zau people, or they are called Zomi people, and they are staying basically in the frontiers of Indo and the Myanmar region. Now, all right, so the Zau people or the Zumi people are basically indigenous people or indigenous community which are staying along the frontiers of India and the Burma. And they are also considered as a subgroup of, all right, so they are the people which live and have the similar in terms of language and the habitats to the Paite and Smite peoples. Okay, now this Zau people or the Zu people or the Zomi people, which are officially recognized in India as one of the 33 indigenous groups. Indigenous groups means they are the original inhabitants which are staying in our country, right, since the ancient period of the time. So they are considered as the 33 indigenous people among one of the 33 indigenous peoples groups within the state of Manipur. And they are also considered as one of the scheduled tribes in the state. Okay, now according to 2001 census, the Zau people or Zumi people or Zo population in the Manipur is around just 20,000 only. Okay, so which consists of less than 3% of the population of the state of Manipur, the 3% of the population of the state of Manipur. And this community is mainly concentrated in, you know, is basically Churandrapur and Chandil district of Manipur. So these are the two districts where the Zau population concentration is maximum. So they are basically Churachandpur and Chandil district of Manipur. So what is the news? The news which is flashing that the Zomi people, which are also the indigenous community, which are the inhabitants of the frontiers of the India and the Burma or Myanmar, and they are also staying in the state of the Manipur, which is a northeastern state. And they have started demanding for the Zuland Territorial Council, which is on the lines of the Bodoland Territorial Councils. And they are considered indigenous, and they are also recognized as one of the 33 indigenous peoples group, which are staying in the state of Manipur, and they are also one of the scheduled tribes, isn't it? And the population in the Manipur, according to 2001 census, is around 20,000 people, and which is a less than 3% of the population of the state of Manipur. In the state of Manipur, and you must understand that they are mainly concentrated in the two districts of the Manipur, which are Churachandpur and Chandel districts of Manipur. All right. Now, so let's look at how these people looks like. These Zhao people, these people looks like, good. All right. So let's move to the new news. All right. So the new news basically is grand challenge for strengthening COVID vaccine intelligent network. Okay. So this is in the short form, you can say that the COVID challenge for strengthening COVID vaccine intelligent network. Okay. So it is a short form of COVID. All right. So this is a short form of COVID. So you must understand what is that? What is the news which is flashing is that the Union Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, along with the Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology, that is MeitY, and the Union Ministry of Health and Welfare, that is in the short form is MOHFW. Both ministries have announced the launching of the COVID. COVID, that means it is a grand challenge for the strengthening of COVID vaccine intelligence network system. So what is this COVID vaccine intelligence network system? So you must understand it is an intelligence network system, just like a normal intelligence. Okay. So it will collect the information. It will collect information. First of all, it is a platform. It is a digital platform, right? Where it will be used, right? It will be used to monitor the rollout and the scale up of operations, which is related to the COVID vaccine distribution system. All right, so it will be basically a collaborative platform, right, which will be developed under the aegis of the Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology, and which will basically build up a synergies in the Indian tech startup space, and that will basically, you know, effectively scale up the mechanism for COVID vaccine distribution system nationally. And such challenge generally would invite the participation from talented and innovative startups throughout the country and emerging technology specialists to augment and the scale up of COVID platform so that basically can effectively roll out and scale up the mechanisms for the COVID vaccine distribution system. All right. So this is basically a grand challenge for strengthening. It is a grand challenge so that it can invite the, you know, the participation from the various innovative startups, right, and emerging technologies specialist startups, so that it can augment such platform, it can basically scale up such platform so that it can better facilitate the COVID vaccine intelligence network system in our country whenever the vaccine is available. All right, now the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, that is MOHFW, have identified 7 focus areas of technology development, right? So 7 focus areas have been identified, right? Which will be holistically address, some sort of a limitations which are associated with a complete and effective vaccine distribution system. So you must understand whenever the vaccine will be available, so you have to have certain set of technological development so that these vaccines are distributed throughout the country, right? To reaches to the corners of the country and nobody would be left out. You have to ensure that no one would be left out, right? So that no people would be left out without the vaccine. And you need to administer that system also. So it need basically the seamless administration across the country. And such steps would require the tremendous technological integration with the medical science or with the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. So that is why the Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology collaborated with the Union Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, right, in order to make this system more holistic, more fulfilled, and more optimistic so that it can it can basically holistically address the limitations which is related to the vaccine distribution system in our country. All right, and this challenge, the grand challenge, basically kick start with the registration process. So this is the registration process. You can log in out, right? And it will open for the participant to apply till 15th January 2020, which can basically you know, which can basically, you know, can bring such type of innovative startups, emerging technology applications, specialists, so that it can scale up such platform to that level so that it can basically handle such a bigger challenge, which is related to the vaccine distribution intelligence network, and which is related to a very important step in strengthening the COVID related challenges, isn't it? So all such things need to be taken care properly before we start the COVID vaccine, you know, vaccination system. All right. Now let's understand briefly about this grand challenge, which is related to the COVID vaccine intelligence network. Okay, so it is, short form is COVID. So first of all, this network basically would ensure that there will be a portability, the safe vaccine transportation, right? The focus areas that I was telling you, the 7 focus areas was identified, right, for the technological development, so that it can holistically address the effective vaccine distribution system. So the first focus area is high adherence rate. Okay. The second is ensuring portability. The third is basically the vaccine transportation. Next is QI management. Then reporting AEFI and the learning management system, logistic management information system. So all such focus areas require the technological integration, and such technological integration require the technological advancement, technological integration with the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. Then only it can ensure that the proper delivery of the vaccine, the proper distribution of the vaccine throughout the country, right, which reaches to every corner of the country, would be ensured. Otherwise, it will be very difficult to administer such a bigger scale project, which will be ensuring that whole country will be vaccinated, right, because of this COVID related challenges. All right. So such things are required, the tremendous management of the vaccine intelligent network. All right. Next, Bharat Skills. Let's understand what is the Bharat Skills. So the Directorate General of Training. So it is basically, you know, an authority which is related to, some sort of a training related skills. Okay. Which has joined hand, right, with the Microsoft and NASCOM Foundation to provide a digital content for ITI student. All right. So you have basically the ITI students. You might have heard about this trade. So ITI students are there, right, in order to provide the ITI students with the digital content, the digital lectures, the digital information, right, all such around 120,000 students which belongs to, or which are also called the ITI students, right, and which are studying in around 3,000 ITI colleges across the India, are going to be benefited through this digitized e-learning module. And this digitized e-learning module will be operated through the Bharat Skill portal. So this portal will be created, Bharat Skill portal. And through this Bharat Skill portal, the ITI colleges would be integrated. And such ITI colleges through a bigger network, right? And through that, the e-learning module will be provided to the students, which are belongs to 3,000 ITI colleges across the country, and around 120,000 students is going to be benefited out of this Bharat Skill portal. All right. So already the Directorate General of Training, that is DGT, has already launched the online learning portal, which is also called the Bharat Skill portal. This is the address of the website. You can already log in. You can already go there. And you can basically check it out, all information which is related to the digital e-learning, which is basically associated with the ITI. All right. Now, what is this Bharat Skill repository or Bharat Skill portal? So first of all, you must understand the Bharat Skill portal is a central repository where the information will be collected at one place, and this information will be used for skilling providing. And that will provide an easy access for the trainees, okay? The students which are studying, right, in the ITI colleges, as well as for the trainers who train the ITI students for innovative ecosystem, ITI ecosystem. and that will also include, right, so that it can have the updated curriculums, updated course content, isn't it? And you know, the Craftsman training schemes, the updated question banks, mock practice paper, the learning videos, and hence everything which are there, right, anywhere you can basically access them, which is also outside your classroom framework. So that will basically become more handy for the students, for the trainees, for the trainers, and they will also able to access the updated curriculums, course content, and that too in the digital e-learning module phase. Okay, so that will be beneficial for around 3,000 ITI institutions which are functioning in our country, and more than 120,000 students will be getting ultimately benefited out of such the Bharat Skill Portal. All right, now this portal or this platform is presenting a unique access to the centralized, scalable, and thriving supportive ecosystems. Okay, where the content will be provided in the digitized form, in the e-learning form, and this platform will also be integrated to the industrial partners for the students and the teachers who can now learn new skills. So that is Industrial Revolution 4.0 skills. So this form is basically the Industrial Revolution 4.0. So new skills will be learned, right? These new skills would be used, right, for the better placement of the students which are basically coming out from such ITI colleges. Because you must understand now according to the McKinsey report, right, you can also check it out, that the most of the students which are coming out, or around 70% 75% of the students which are coming out from the engineering colleges and ITI institutions, right, ITI means industrial training institutions. So always remember, ITI means industrial training institutions. Okay, so that is industrial training institutions. Okay, so these industrial training institutions are also having different streams also. All right, so such students which are coming out, they are not employable because they don't have the required skill which is required as per the demand of the industry. So if you provide them the required skill which is as per the demand of the industry, isn't it, on the real time basis, that will also enhance the employability of the students. That will enhance the employability of the students, and that will also boost the economy, because once the employment is available to the students, right, they will again bring some sort of a demand on the market. All right, and such things will also bring ultimately boost the productivity of the economy, and ultimately the economy is going to be benefited in the long run. So ultimately, this industrial training institutions or ITI institutions, which are around 3,000 in the number, is going to be benefited out of such digitized training or e-learning platform, which is also called Bharat Skill Learning Platform. And through this learning platform, the trainees, trainers of such ITI ecosystem will get the updated curriculums and course content so that they can benefit it out of it, and they can basically use that content to bring the newer skills which are also in the nature of Industrial Revolution 4.0. And such IR 4.0 skills would be handy to fulfill the demands of the industries in India as well as in the abroad. Because you must understand, India is basically the India's population, you say 40% of India's population is at working population, right? If that working population is basically used, so that is called demographic dividend. If such demographic dividend is basically used by the India by skilling its population, right? So we need basically skilling the population, empowering the population by providing them the innovative skills, by providing them the updated curriculums, by providing them the better content materials. So that will basically handy for the people, for the trainees, and ultimately we can also, or we means the India can also fulfill the shortage of such technical manpower in the world, which is going to be coming. And according to the UN, one report suggests that India may fulfill the shortage of the technical manpower, provided India use its demographic dividend, right? India use its the manpower to skill them. to skill them, to better skilling them so that they can basically employable anywhere in the world or anywhere in the any part of the country. So that's how this is the Bharat platform, the Bharat platform repository. So this would be basically the picture, you can look into it. Okay, next, ammonia. So the news which is coming, it related to the Indian Farmers Fertilizer Corporation Limited, that is called IFFCO. So that Indian Farmer Fertilizers Corporation, that is basically a public sector undertaking. The unit which is at Prayagraj, okay? Okay, that Prayagraj basically we call Allahabad. Its name recently changed by the Yogi Adityanath government. Okay, so it is known as Prayagraj. Okay, so here at this plant, which is also called Indian Farmers Fertilizer Cooperative System, Cooperative Limited, at this plant, two persons died. And several persons basically got ill because of the ammonia gas which has leaked out from this plant. Now, this ammonia is basically, you know, it is trihydride of nitrogen. And you must understand, the ammonia is basically used in the agriculture because of agriculture and basically the nitrogenous fertilizer, in the construction of the nitrogenous fertilizers. And it is also a building block for ammonium nitrate, right? That will be ultimately used in the agriculture. Now, this ammonia which is there in the industrial applications, now it is stored in the industrial use in the liquid form. So just like a normal liquid petroleum gas, LPG. So it is also stored in the cylinder, right? Under the high pressure. So just like that, ammonia is also stored in the cylinders under high pressure. If you want to store in the gaseous form, you have to put its temperature to the lowest level so that it can be in the gaseous form. Right. So ammonia has its chemical properties. For example, ammonia is soluble in the water. Okay. So it is found in the basically soil, air, right, and in the water. And you must understand, it is also present naturally in the human body also, right? And the human body also secrete, you know, the ammonia through this, from the kidneys, right? From the kidneys in order to neutralize this excess acid. All right, and since it is highly diluted, so it does not affect the human body as it is in the concentrated form. And as I told you, that uses of ammonia is very high in the industrial applications. It is also used in the fertilizer formation, right? And these fertilizers are basically used in the farmers, in the farm fields, isn't it? And and you must understand, we are also one of the highest users of the nitrogenous fertilizers in the world. And it is also used in the synthetic chemicals which is produced in the world. And more than 80% of the ammonia which is made up and which is consumed in the manufacturing of the fertilizers, and most of the remainder goes to the production of formaldehyde. So it is having tremendous industrial applications in the world, not in our country, but also throughout the world. All right. So this is the depiction where one victim of the ammonia, which is also shown that the scientist basically collecting the samples, right? All right. And another news which is coming out, that coronavirus also reached to the Antarctica also. Antarctica, right? To the deeper southern pole. So it reaches to the Antarctica. So at least 36 people basically infected in the Antarctica, which is at Chilean research station. So there are a lot of research stations in the Antarctica region, right? So 36 people basically infected from the coronavirus, right? And this is the first such instance which is basically in the news from the southernmost continent. So you must understand, these all 36 people were basically stationed at General, you know, Bernardo O'Higgins Reculum. It is basically a station name which is located on the northernmost tip of Antarctica, and which is also facing the southern Chilean coast. All right, so it is basically a Chilean research station. Now you must understand, there are nearly 60 permanent stations established by various countries. All right, and India has also established the research stations at the Antarctica. So for example, the Indian research stations are basically named at Maitri and the Bharati, which is also a permanent stations or permanent research stations which are also located in the Antarctica. All right, but Indian research stations are intact from this coronavirus. And you must understand, these Indian research stations are at least 5,000 kilometers away from this Chilean base or from the Chilean research station. So, and when you compare this Maitri and the Bharati, even two stations are themselves almost 3,000 kilometers away. So there is no need to get panic regarding the safety of the Indian missions or Indian permanent stations in the Antarctica. They are all secure and they are well protected. All right. And when you say the nodal agency for India's scientific expeditions in the Antarctica and the Arctic, it is basically a National Center for Polar and Ocean Research. It is basically a nodal agency which will be responsible for India's research expeditions in the Antarctica and the Arctic, and it is located in the Goa. All right. So this is, you can say, it is a Bharati and Maitri, which is around 3,900 kilometers away from each other. All right. So next is municipal bond. So let's understand municipal bond. So Vadodara Municipal Council, which is a municipal council at Vadodara, which is basically a municipality in the Gujarat state. So it has basically, you know, expected to launch a municipal bonds. So let me clear what is this municipal bonds is all about. So municipal bonds are basically issued by a sovereign body, okay, based on the permission given by the state government. Now you must understand, these municipal corporations are issuing these bonds, right, so that it can get the cheap credit from the market or from the people. So ultimately this credit would be used, right, or this credit would be used or to raise the money, and this money would be used ultimately for the developmental work. So the Vadodara Municipal Corporation is the third such corporation, right, in the Gujarat, which is expected to issue the municipal bonds in the January 2021. Now, this method of raising the money is not new in our India, but such money have been already raised in the Gujarat. For example, Ahmedabad was the first city in the Gujarat which has raised the money, and Ahmedabad was the only first Asian city, or you say in the whole South Asia, the Ahmedabad was the first city which has launched this the municipal bond of 100 crore, and this 100 crore was basically used in the development purpose in 1998 itself. And the Surat Municipal Corporation was the second municipal corporation which was also the second city in the Gujarat to announce such bonds in 2018. And now in 2020, the Vadodara Municipal Corporation is expected to launch the municipal bond. Ultimately, that would be used, right, under Atal Mission for Rejuvenation and the Urban Transformation. Okay, Amrut Mission. You might have heard about this Amrut Mission. So under this, the raised money would be utilized by the municipal corporation. Okay, so this is the municipal corporation and this is the map of the Gujarat. All right, let's understand the next news, that is Sugatha Kumari. So it is basically, or she was basically an eminent Malayalam poet. So she was basically an eminent Malayalam poet. She was also a woman activist. She was also a conservationist. And she was recently passed away at the age of 86. So she was 86 years old. And she was born in 1934. And she died in 2020. And she was an Indian poet and activist, right? And she was one of the forefront of the environmental movement in India, as well as the feminist movement in Kerala. And she began her, you know, writing and the literary life, for a weekly in 1957, right? Under the pen name Sri Kumar, right? So she was publishing this Sri Kumar continuously, right? And she was fondly called as a Sugatha teacher. Her poems were basically filled with lot of empathy, lot of sensitivity, lot of the philosophical quest for various purposes. For example, for the feminist movement, for environmental protection, for environmental movements. So her poems or her literary traditions, her literary life, we were totally filled with empathy, sensitivity, and philosophical texts. All right. And in late 1970s, she was successful nationwide movement, which was known as Survey Silent Valley, right? This was ultimately to save some of the oldest natural forest in our country. The Silent Valley is located in the Kerala, right? From planned hydroelectric project. So this hydroelectric project require the submersion of certain the forest areas, because for the hydroelectric project you need to pound a minimum amount of water in the dam, and ultimately through the dam the water will be channelized through a channel, and this channel would require, or this dam site and the channels would require to cut down a certain amount of the forest. And this dam site is also required that water should be filled. And if the water is going to be filled, ultimately certain area would be completely immersed or submerged. And for that, a lot of vegetation, a lot of forest life, fauna life will get ultimately affected, right? So this Saugata Kumari was one such eminent person who held this environmental movement in the Kerala's Silent Valley, right? From which basically, you know, accredited, right, in terms of the protection of the forest, or in terms of protection of the forest from the such planned hydroelectric projects in 1970. And her poem, which was also known as Marathinu Situti, or Ode to the Tree, okay? Such poem was become a symbol of the protest, and it was highly reverberated in all parts of the country, which was also related to the saving of the Silent Valley campaign, right? Okay, and she was also the founder secretary of the Prakriti Samrakshita Samiti, which is an organization which was ultimately related to the protection of the nature. And she was also founded the Abhaya. This Abhaya was the home for the destitute women and daycare center for the mentally ill, the women. So this shows that she has some sort of an orientation towards the feminist movement also, because she set the home for the destitute women and the daycare centers for the mentally ill persons, especially the women. And the Saugata Kumari was also the first chairperson of Kerala State Women Commission. Okay. And her tenure was marked by the launch of Kudambashree missions. You might have heard about the Kudambashree mission. It is a successful NGO which is working in the state of Kerala, which has had the great contribution in terms of uplifting the poor people out of from the poverty. And it is also conducting a few of the successful projects for the women empowerment in the Kerala, especially the women empowerment in the Kerala. All right. So it is the news which is flashing regarding the Saugata Shree. All right. So it is Saugata Kumari. All right. So she was a Saugata Kumari. You can look it. You can look the picture. All right. So that's all for the news. All right. And thank you very much for attending this class. And we will meet again in our next class. So tomorrow, 26th of December, 2020, and we'll bring the new news for the Hindu newspaper, from the Hindu newspaper. All right. So thank you very much for attending this session. Thank you very much. Thank you.